Today we're talking about Trump negotiations that are actually going somewhere. The trade war. Turns out it might actually be easier to talk to the Chinese than Democrats. An American delegation recently went to China to see if maybe we said the exact same thing a fifth time something would change. Turns out it did, with China coming up with some very creative offers including completely eliminating their trade surplus over the next 6 years. Which, mission accomplished, guys, right? Now we can go back to filling our closet with cheap made-in-China garbage Marie Kondo can teach us to throw out. Well, that is, except that maybe out of reflex, Trump's team said no deal. So let's get started.
On to the trade dispute between the U.S. and China, Beijing has offered to reduce its trade surplus, which stood at $323 billion last year, to zero by the year 2024.
That certainly sounds hard to say no to. I mean, what's next? Are they going to offer to build us a great wall? This might sound too good to be true, so let's go over the details. The main thing is, this is a squeaky wheel gets the oil type situation, because it's less China increasing their imports and more China importing things from the United States as opposed to other countries. For example, forget Brazilian soybeans, we're going exclusively American now. And let me tell you, with this proposal's amended soybean purchases, forget corn, Ohio's gonna be making so much soy their state bird will soon be the tofurkey. This will also move the dial on Chinese car purchases, airplane purchases, and petroleum purchases from America. And I'd love it if all this enthusiasm for buying American was because they wanted it, but their enthusiasm for American products does feel slightly disingenuous. We're talking about a ton of money, though.
More news about what China might be tabling, and that is a large package of asset purchases. Bloomberg is reporting that that size of that package could be $1 trillion and that it would extend through 2024.
$1 trillion in additional exports. Someone's getting desperate. So we have quite the offer. Why are we not jumping for joy? First, that felt suspiciously easy. If you offer someone 20 bucks for their car and they say, okay, you're probably gonna want to pay less than 20 bucks for that car. More importantly, while this does fix the symptom that got us into the trade war, it doesn't fix the underlying issue bothering our negotiators. To some, like our trade representative Lighthizer, it would be like having your bully agree to not take your lunch money when he beats you up anymore, and saying, see, it's fair now. They see a structural problem in which we're literally trading beans for computers. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's a lot of beans. So many, in fact, that there are some worries we currently don't have the capacity to fulfill their hypothetical orders. But the point is,
these are the kind of things that you can get done in a month's time span. They're not going to get a deal with China on deep changes in its protection of intellectual property and some of the other grievances that the Trump administration has. But China can easily agree to buy more, and they put that on the table. The U.S. can agree to cut back or at least not continue to raise tariffs. They put that on the table. So we're now talking about the kinds of things that can get done in a month, and that should raise optimism.
We entered this war saying we wanted to balance the trade surplus, but our reluctance to accept this deal that solves our main gripe shows that there's more going on below the surface. And while nuance is fun in your favorite young adult novel, it's really not helpful in international trade deals. Chinese leaders are finding themselves again asking us what it is we're fighting for. The conversation has now shifted heavily towards forced technology transfer, government-sponsored cyber theft, international property enforcement, and government support of certain industries. Surprisingly enough, those are bigger asks than $1 trillion additional dollars in exports, leading to harder future negotiations.
Within his own administration, this has been very much the fight. And in fact, Lighthizer and others have often pushed to not have a deal that was just seen as a big buying spree, but was, and therefore took the pressure off the structural reforms that people tend to care about or think are the most important.
Boy, I have to take a second to tell you, the trade war narrative has changed pretty significantly from this is a bad idea to we're only getting $1 trillion from them? Come on, we can do better than that. Trump, this really seems to have worked a lot better than I predicted. So go get that double quarter pounder and you know what? Get the fries today. You deserve it. In the wise words of George W. Bush, I continue to misunderestimate you. So how are they doing on these structural reforms? Well, I made an entire episode about this, but the Cliff Notes version is that China has proposed a law that says China can't mandate technology transfers from companies looking to participate in the Chinese market. But at the same time, they consistently deny that happens, so that should help. Also, it's a proposed law, so I'm sure that's going to get codified pretty soon. Another proposed law bans companies stealing intellectual property from selling bonds or getting other forms of financing. But hey, you have all those new free IPs now, so maybe they don't need financing. Also, you can't steal intellectual property. That's the Chinese government's job. Lastly, China is exponentially increasing the number of trademark cases they have to 31,000 in 2018. So goodbye, Crust Toothpaste, 712, and Obama Fried Chicken. Wow, not even gonna touch that last one. These reforms are so insignificant, though I can't even find a clip of pundits talking about how empty a gesture it is. So what's next in the talks?
Chinese Vice Premier Liu He has accepted an invitation by U.S. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin and U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer to visit Washington, D.C. on January 30th and 31st.
They're coming to the White House on the 30th, if it hasn't been foreclosed on. Thank God they're coming soon, those burgers won't last much longer. So our Trade Representative Lighthizer and our Treasury Secretary Mnuchin are going to be meeting with the Chinese Vice Premier in order to negotiate what we want beyond no trade deficit. I've done a few episodes on Lighthizer, and let me tell you, this meeting is not going to be pleasant. Lighthizer is a free market advocate who's going to be looking to force Chinese officials to force the country of China out of China's markets. Which, well, that's going to be a hard pill to swallow. Especially with President Xi saying he won't be pressured into letting outsiders rate his country's policies. Which is kind of our new trade war goal. This brings us to our final question. China, why are you being so generous?
As far as I'm concerned, it's a hard deadline. When I talk to the President of the United States, he's not talking about going beyond March. He's talking about getting a deal. If there's a deal to be gotten, we want to get it in the next 90 days.
If you like looming deadlines, well, here's another one for you. If we don't have a deal signed by March 1st, the United States is going to be putting 25% tariffs across the board. And that will seriously just wreck global trade. Now, under any other president, I'm sure Chinese officials would be less alarmed. But hoo-wee, our current president seems to not have a tendency towards self-preservation, and will drive this car into oncoming traffic to avoid paying a toll. China is so eager to get this thorn out of their side because while this trade war is happening in a separate story,
they were trying in any case to get the debt under control, the shadow banking system under control. They were trying to do a rebalance of the economy away from too much construction investment, too much debt financed investment. And right in the middle of that very difficult transition, which I think they were managing quite well, they were hit by the tariffs, hit by the trade war. And this is a significant slowdown of the Chinese economy.
In the middle of a large economic transformation, the Americans hit them with a trade war. And while not having the largest impact directly on their economy, it's had an enormous impact on speculation. They're currently trying to open the economy to international investment. But when you think of the Chinese economy right now, odds are you think first and foremost of the trade war. Having the trade war escalate again risks really throwing a monkey wrench into their economic growth and reform. The question most people watching these negotiations right now are asking is, what does the Trump administration want? Which is not a great question to be asking a year into this thing. We might still take the offer to clear our trade surplus and move on with our lives feeling pretty darn good about what we accomplished. But we could also hold the line and push forward with more reform demands. If we think China will accept the Trump administration taking a Sharpie to some of their domestic policies, then again, their president is saying,
there is no textbook to follow. No one is in a position to dictate to the Chinese people what should or should not be done.
So we might have to keep digging before we get that treasure chest. For the meantime, though, I am looking forward to seeing what comes out of this Washington, D.C. meeting scheduled for the 30th. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.